Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are raising a glass to a princess, a general, and a definite force to be reckoned with. That's right, we are honoring Leia Organa from the Star Wars series with a drink that I am calling a Café Olea. The ingredients that you will need to make this drink are whiskey, cream, coffee, a little bit of rumchata, and some brown sugar simple syrup. While you go wrangle all of that up, I am going to start the story of Leia. Leia was originally developed by George Lucas as a primary character in his series Star Wars. Originally, in 1971, George had wanted to develop the Flash Gordon serial from the 1930s into a film series. However, he couldn't get the rights, so he decided to write his own space opera. Leia is present in very early drafts of the story, but it would of course take decades to tell her full story. If you've never seen a Star Wars movie, fuck, man, there's like so much backstory. It's very hard to encapsulate all of it in just a few minutes. It is a trilogy of trilogies, which was developed out of sequence. The first three films were released between 1977 and 1983. Then there was a second trilogy, a prequel trilogy, that was released between 1999 and 2005. And then finally, a sequel trilogy that was released between 2015 and 2019. It is the original trilogy developed in the 70s that really has the meatiest part of Leia's character. I'm saying, though, that like her story really took 40 years to be told, and I'm gonna try to tell it in about 40 seconds. So if you have seen all of the Star Wars movies, just like go easy on me. I'm doing the best I can. To do that, I though am going to need a little bit to drink. We're gonna start by adding some ice to our shaker, and then I don't know if I even need booze to tell this story. I think I might just need coffee. So we're gonna add 1.5 ounces of coffee to our shaker. And the rest of it is, you know, for me. Woo! Okay, here we go. So Leia is basically the catalyst for the entire Star Wars series. It starts with a galaxy that's in the middle of a civil war, and Leia, who is this princess of a planet called Alderaan, she's also the leader of a rebellion against the Sith. They're like the bad guys. That's who Darth Vader is. He's a Sith. So she gets the plans for the Death Star. She goes on a mission, she gets these plans, she's gonna take them back to the rebels so that they know the weaknesses of the Death Star. And you remember the Death Star, it's like that big, like, moon thing that's kind of like a planet but also a spaceship. Well, she wants to blow it up, so she's gonna get these plans back to her rebel buddies, but then she gets captured. However, she has the foresight to take the plans and pop them in a droid, R2-D2, sends him off into the galaxy, and that's what gets the whole ball rolling. So to make a long story short, Leia helps the rebels and her new pals, Luke and Han, destroy the Death Star. Eventually, she falls in love with Han, she goes undercover to save him, she's imprisoned as a sex slave to a giant slug, she kills the slug, she saves Han, she finds out that Darth Vader is her father, which means that Luke is her twin brother, even though they shared this really strange kiss in the first movie. These three movies, this original trilogy, is what truly established Leia's character and her status as a feminist icon. From the beginning, Leia was not afraid to confront the authority figures in her male-dominated world and tell them that they fucking suck. She watches Darth Vader blow up her planet in front of her very eyes, and she keeps her shit remarkably together. When Han Solo and Luke come and like save her, she is the first person to critique that they are doing a sloppy job. Ultimately, she just takes Luke's blaster, shoots them out of the shitty situation that they're in. Anyone who calls her a damsel in distress is truly not paying attention. She saves others as often as she is saved. I mean, who saves Han Solo from the carbonite? It's Leia, y'all! And Luke, when he's all in distress in Cloud City, it's Leia's sensitivity to the Force that ends up saving his life. Leia is gutsy from the get-go. At times, she's aggressive and maybe a little snarky, but never at the expense of also being feminine. She fights like a boy, but she is totally a woman. You know, she falls in love and at various moments demonstrates tremendous warmth and empathy. we are going to add some warmer notes to our cocktail. We're going to add in a 1/2 ounce of brown sugar simple syrup. The brown sugar simple syrup gives a really nice warmth, a nice like molasses-y flavor. And we're going to add 2 ounces of cream. I like the cream because it has a nice white flow that reminds me of Leia's dress from the original film. Now, Leia's costuming has, of course, been the subject of discussion for decades. Her original dress was worn with no bra because George Lucas explained to her that there is no underwear in space because of zero gravity. This was a decision that Carrie Fisher, the actress who played Leia, was not that enthused about. She didn't follow George's completely illogical train of thought, but she was even less enthused about some of the costuming that was to come, including, of course, the metal bikini. The famous metal bikini is undoubtedly the basis for thousands, nay millions, of nerd sex fantasies over the last 40 years. Imagine how many computer programmers and CFOs have had their birthdays celebrated by wives and girlfriends cosplaying Leia. It's important, however, to point out that even in her slave bikini, Leia is still a feminist, because Leia is just in that bikini biding her time until the moment when she is able to take the chains that are literally binding her and use them to strangle her captor. That is subverting the patriarchy, my friends. Of course, Leia's most iconic fashion moment came in the first film with her hairstyle, which Carrie Fisher also hated. She claimed to be self-conscious about what she considered her chubby cheeks and didn't want any piles of hair added to the sides of her face to make it even whiter. George Lucas said the hairstyle was inspired by soldaderas, the women who were fighting in the Mexican Revolution at the turn of the last century. Scholars had trouble substantiating this claim initially, but eventually found a photo of Clara de la Rocha that showed a clear connection between the styles of the soldaderas and Princess Leia in her cinnamon buns. As a nod to the cinnamon buns, I'm going to add some cinnamon notes to our cocktail. I'm going to start by adding 1 ounce of Rumchata, which is a cream cinnamon liqueur. And then actually, I already added cinnamon notes in my coffee because what I had was a cinnamon bun coffee. If you would like to add a pinch of cinnamon to your cocktail, now is the moment to do it. Now, after the massive success of the original Star Wars trilogy, it is not surprising that filmmakers wanted to add to the trilogy. In 2015, Disney and J.J. Abrams completed the trilogy of trilogies with 3 movies that ended the stories of the main trio, Han, Luke, and Leia. In these films, Leia has evolved into General Organa, running the fucking rebel army like the badass warrior princess we always knew she was. At this point, her son, Ben, has gone over to the dark side. Ultimately, he kills her husband, his father. Meanwhile, her brother Luke is off living on the side of a mountain, and she's kind of on her own, just like running half the galaxy. It's not until the final film, Rise of Skywalker, that the series addresses the death of Leia. This was necessary in part because Carrie Fisher died suddenly prior to the filming of Rise of Skywalker. Carrie Fisher, of course, had her own amazing life story. Now, unlike Leia, she wasn't separated at birth from her twin brother and sent to a far-off planet to live as royalty, but she was descended from Hollywood royalty. Her mother was actress Debbie Reynolds, and her father was singer Eddie Fisher. By the time she was 3 years old, her parents were in the middle of a very public divorce because her father had cheated on her mother with her mother's best friend Liz. And by Liz, of course, I mean Elizabeth Taylor. Now, when she was filming Star Wars, Carrie Fisher was, like her character Leia, only 19 years old. But because of her childhood, she really had the maturity of a much older person. And she was someone who already knew quite a bit about being famous. But Star Wars catapulted her to a bizarre level of fame. She wasn't known as Carrie Fisher. She was known as Leia. And her likeness was everywhere. Her face was on lunchboxes and backpacks, on board games. There were dolls and costumes. She was a Pez dispenser. Carrie talked about all of this and more in her one-woman show called Wishful Drinking. On top of being an actress, Carrie was an accomplished writer and a mental health advocate. She adapted her novel, Postcards from the Edge, which dealt with mental health and addiction, into an Oscar-nominated film. She wrote several different memoirs, the last of which, The Princess Diarist, drew on the diaries that she kept during her years filming the Star Wars franchise. It details, among other things, her illicit affair with Han Solo actor Harrison Ford.
So when she said, "I love you," he really did know.
What I know is that this cocktail needs a little extra kick. So we're gonna add 1 ounce of whiskey to this cocktail before we shake it and give it a good strain. Now, what a lot of people don't know about Carrie Fisher is that she was not only a writer in her own right, but she was also a well-known script doctor. She made many contributions to films that we all know and love, including Hook, Sister Act, The Wedding Singer, and more. All of this began during her time playing Leia. She would change dialogue frequently, shaping her character not only on screen, but behind the scenes as well. Oh, this looks delicious. Perfect, that same creamy white color of Leia's dress. Let's give it a taste. Oh, it's nice. It's very creamy. You get just enough of the cinnamon and like a little kick from the whiskey. It's like Leia, soft and creamy and inviting, but it also packs a punch. And a blaster pistol. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm gonna be back on Wednesday with a new lady and a new libation. I'm going to start posting new episodes Monday, Wednesday, and Friday with repeats posted on my Instagram feed on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So you can follow me there at Feminist Cocktail Hour. Until then, may the force be with you. And of course, cheers.
Let's go, girls.
Come on.